switched right when you flipped the switch, it turned. It's like you did something.
All right, welcome to the Site Plan Review Technical Advisory Committee work session for February 11th. First item on the agenda is 132-134 Middle Street for a conditional use permit for parking. And the parking part of our role with this conditional use permit for parking is we just make comments. We don't even have to make a formal recommendation to the planning board, but it's just an opportunity to provide input to the applicant on the parking request, and any comments we want to forward to planning board will be forwarded, and you're welcome to talk about any other issues, John, that you want to raise as well.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if the plan's in that set, but we also have some utility work to talk about, but the applicant...
Utility plan's in there, too.
Okay, cool. The applicant purchased has a purchase and sale agreement for 132-134 Middle Street. The property is actually two lots. It's one building, but there is an existing lot line that goes down the middle of the building. It's an existing apartment building on the 134 side of the building. There was a dentist's office in this corner, so there was a commercial unit as a part of the building, and that use has been abandoned for some period of time. The new owner wants to remodel the building and bring it up to code, so not just take that unit and turn it into something else, but to really upgrade this building into a new and usable apartment building. There'd be an additional one unit. The commercial unit would transition into a residential unit. The only other change, if we look at this is the utility plan. The conditional use permit plan shows something different. But I can talk.
We have it on here, so.
I can talk about the utilities, or if you have it on there.
Yep, we have it on here. I think we have it in here.
On our second plan, there's a bunch of utilities.
Second plan?
On the utilities.
Oh, no, we don't have the conditional use permit plan. I'm sorry, John.
Okay.
Describe it.
That's the utility plan.
You just have the
utility. That's a conditional use plan?
Yeah, this is the condition, because there were two workshop requests. So this is the conditional use plan. I guess I can pass it around. It shows the cars, sort of parking, as you will, on the site.
I can see if I can pull it up.
If you want, while we're at that one, I can just point out the utilities before you go to the end.
I got the real stuff.
Right? Then you want a transformer there or no?
John probably needs it back. Maybe not. Do you need to talk to it, John, from it? Pat's got it.
If we get it on the screen, there's additional material that I did submit that I don't have, but
it's limited here.
Yeah.
Drive out on this side too.
With the lawn there.
Does it have the, have you got yours up?
Well, we don't have this. You can
use it. I was just looking for the other paperwork. Which is in here. So if you want, I can give you this plan back.
I can look at it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we submitted a number of things, a trip generation memo that looked at the conversion of the commercial space to housing. And identified the number of trips, and the reuse from the commercial to the residential, in our opinion, is not gonna be burdensome to the network.
I pulled up that memo, but I didn't pull.
It should be all together, though, right?
There are two, there, you uploaded the site plan separately, it's okay.
Oh, okay.
What's the total number of units now?
So existing, there are, if you look on the note four, lot 11, which is the southerly part of the building that had the commercial use, was 9 residential and 1 commercial, and it's proposed to be 10 residential. The northerly building, which is 132, is 11 residential units, and that's not gonna change. There is some space that's gonna be taken over in the basement that will be repurposed. There'll be some access and egress improvements for life safety. There's gonna be one change to the exterior, which is just the introduction of a lift here to provide ADA access up to this platform and into the building. This plan shows currently what would be, I think, parking spaces that are either available or currently used. Right now, there's a space that is used here in the front. Somebody parks there, one of the unit, mm-hmm. one of the tenants parks there. And then you could stack, based on the dimensional requirements, two here. They would have to be assigned to the same unit. Same thing here, you could stack two, which would be assigned to the same unit. There is a fence here, and the property has deeded rights of access out to State Street. So vehicles can come in here, and we would have stacking here and an extra spot there. So there currently are 8 parking spaces on the site, or that would be available. The requirement under the ordinance is based on the unit sizes, and there's a unit size table over here in the on the conditional use permit plan, listing the unit and the unit areas, 21 units total, but based on the parking space requirement of a half to 1.3 and the visitor requirements, the total parking demand would be 24 spaces. In the submitted material, I talked a little bit about the proximity of the downtown and reductions that might be, that might make sense, and it might result in about a 9% reduction in the parking demand. So we're looking for maybe 22 spaces as the parking demand, leaving 14 to 16 spaces short of meeting the ordinance. So that's why we need a conditional use permit. We're looking for your feedback so we can request this of the planning board. It's a situation that exists, and the building renovation, I think, is important for the future of the building, keeping housing close to the downtown and keeping it viable as a housing block. So we're also introducing 2 bike racks to meet the code. So one here and one here. So we're introducing that in accordance with the ordinance.
So the net increase is 1 unit from what is there now?
The net increase is 1 residential unit.
From what's there now?
From what's there now, residential unit.
And how many parking spaces do you estimate that you provide currently?
8.
Okay. And you're proposing to continue to provide 8?
I think that there's been some discussion about whether this parking space here still meets the ordinance, so it might be 7.
Well, I mean, it already exists, so I guess that would be the question, is whether we want to ask them to eliminate a space that already exists.
But I don't think it's going to meet the dimensional, you know. Somebody parks there, they have a small car.
Yep.
I don't think it's 18 feet long or 20 feet long. So in that case, it kind of breaks down.
And the size of the units, is that changing based on the renovation?
Yes.
So the mix of the, right now they're all kind of the same size, and you're going to have a mix of different sizes?
That's a good question. There is an existing plan that I didn't put it in the table, but there's, there is a mix, as you see, there are five units under 500 square feet proposed.
Right.
13 units, 500 to 750 square feet, three units over 750. My guess is that probably three or four of the 500 to 750 units would exist now as under 500.
Okay. That would probably be helpful to know for the planning board. Do you have an idea of how many bedrooms there are proposed?
I'm not sure the bedroom, if the bedroom counts are in the architectural.
It's not something we counted, we asked for, but I don't know if it's in the architectural spot.
Yeah, so you need bedroom counts.
Well, just be, I think it'd be helpful to have an understanding of what the size of each unit, other than the physical size, what the proposed mix of bedroom counts is gonna be.
Some of the, there's been some, not issues, but as you can see, the actual building itself is not in a straight line, so that has caused some consternation with the existing building dimensions that were all done as if the building was square, so some of the numbers have been difficult for the architect to adjust to, or he's had to spend time adjusting the existing.
So some of the concerns I just have about the existing situation is just that the vehicles that are towards the rear get in and out from the rear of the building, or do they come in from the front? How do they access those spots?
There's an existing easement here that goes out to State Street, so you can drive right in from State Street.
That's the only way out.
So then those cars that are parked next to each other, there's room for them to fit in and kind of parallel park there? Is that how that happens?
So there's actually, yeah, these can come in here and turn around. This is all pavement here, so there's room to maneuver around, either coming in and then backing in, or coming in straight and then backing and turning around.
But that car that's parked behind the other one, there's room on the side of that. There's adequate room there dimensionally for them to get by it?
No, it's a stacked space.
It is a stacked space.
Yeah, so there's three of the spaces would have to be, you know, two spaces assigned to the same unit.
Yeah.
Is that currently used right now as a parking space?
Yes, they park along the side, both sides, and in the back.
So one of the things that would be a little bit concerning to me is under our current regulations, those have to be assigned to the same unit. So it really is not providing a parking space for the use of the entire building. It's just for one unit. One unit would have two parking spaces, basically.
Three units.
Three units would have two parking
spaces. Any comments?
Just know from past dealings there that some of the tenants over there park across the street at the church.
Mm-hmm. They have an arrangement? Yeah.
Maybe an arrangement, or it just hasn't been an issue.
Yeah.
There's not a whole lot of parking there. I mean, usually just kind of first come, first serve. I mean, from talking to tenants when we've been there in the past, it's, you know, we'd ask, like, whose car they have no idea because it's just completely random.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not a lot of space there.
Are these going to be rental units? Do you, John?
Yes, single owner.
Do you have an understanding from the client that there'll maybe be some efforts to formalize the parking arrangement that's there? Maybe it's a little informal now and they can make it a little more.
Yeah, I expected the client was going to be here, but they, when I mentioned the stack parking and the assignment to the units, they were, yeah, we'll have to deal with that in the documents.
Have they pursued potentially like agreements with neighboring property owners? For example, the church might be willing to provide some parking at.
They can certainly look into that. As I said, the right now it's under purchase and sale agreement, so.
Okay.
I don't know if that's a formal thing, but we can find out.
It's actually
that
the church is a parking lot right across the street that, like,
back of the
like
church,
some Apple, something. There's a commercial,
you don't mean Fairpoint,
unit right across the street. Mm-hmm. It's
is
right next door to the church.
Eric, is that the property
that
we've looked at before and getting
commercial
city parking?
Building, yeah.
No,
yeah, it's like Fairpoint, maybe it's
right
insurance company.
This one, I
it's a white one.
Here's the site right here,
the white federal.
This is the site. No, it's this parking lot right here.
Yeah.
That's across middle.
Next to the Baptist church.
In back of the Baptist church?
Next door to the Baptist church.
Oh, next door.
It's an insurance company right there.
Sure.
Okay.
Behind that.
So it's commercial during the day?
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah, because I think the city has an agreement to use the Middle Street Baptist Church parking lot for library parking sometimes.
And I don't think State Street, I think State Street allows overnight parking.
Mm-hmm.
So I would assume that some people park.
Yeah.
On State Street.
Correct. So any other comments from TAC that we'd like to forward along?
I just had a question about that building in the back. Does that interfere with the parking, that the two-story that's kind of touching it?
So are you talking about this building?
The one that's not on the lot, the one that's kind of joined that back.
This one?
Yeah, that thing there.
You can drive between them.
You can drive through?
Yeah.
So they don't prohibit, that's just an easement through there? Do they park there?
They, I'm not sure exactly. I haven't seen people park, but they can't block it. They don't block it.
They can't block it, okay.
They're currently using those packs. They're currently using that as a drive-through?
Yes, it's deeded access.
And the other side too, or?
The other side, no, it's fenced off, so.
They use the driveway.
So this is.
Only from that, only from middle?
And some, the, I believe that there are some people that park on the grass here, so, you know, pavement ends. But the new owner would be glad to formalize it and be sure that whatever is recommended goes forward. So we're looking for your feedback on those.
Do they have an easement for the electrical service? Or see on the lot?
In the back?
I heard you about the access easement, but.
Yeah, in the back?
Yeah.
I would, I haven't, I didn't do the survey. I don't know if it's mentioned in the notes, but it's certainly there, so. Yeah, I know, I can get the answer to that.
And they wouldn't be able to get, turn it into one, two.
So do we have any?
Yeah.
Feedback based on current conditions? I mean, not, I don't see that this is really changing current conditions, although we have an opportunity to maybe address some of those. Anybody have any suggestions, Pat?
I'm just curious on, because I guess we're two different things here. One is the parking and then the other is looking at the change of the building. When they changed the building.
Yep.
Plan, will you still have access to every floor, the entirety of every floor from the front entrance, or will it be?
I didn't do the architecturals, but I'm pretty sure that would probably be the case, because you need two points of egress, I'm sure, and there's, so there's one here and there's one here in the back. There's also a door here. So that's a good question. Are you saying that this demising wall, you would want that to have access up?
We don't, yeah, we would need to get back and forth between the two sides, but we would want to be able to access the entire building from the front door, because that's the only place you can get a fire truck anywhere near. And we can right
gotcha.
Now.
Gotcha.
And they could have a single exit if they meet certain exceptions of rating, so.
The plan, just so you know, and that's the second part of our trip here today, is to look at the utilities. And the only utility change so far is bringing in sprinklers. So he's, I think he may have spoken to you about that already.
Yeah, we've met. I just can't remember the entire setup. I think he was gaining some space maybe in some of the units. I don't recall if that was because the common hallway was not going to go front to back anymore.
So the existing plan at the first floor level, I can show you, it has the two entryways and then stairways that are divided by a wall, but then there's a door just to the rear of that that I'm sure can be opened up so that passes can go back and forth.
Yeah, looks like you can get everywhere.
Yeah.
So any.
Make some notes about that. We'll get.
Yeah, I mean, some of that can be.
We can add the floor plans to the set if it helps the planning board.
Yeah, so I think for planning board review, it'd be just helpful to have an understanding of the number of bedrooms and how that might be changing between the current and the proposed.
Okay.
One of the things I just want to let TAC know is this does not meet the criteria for site plan review. So this is an opportunity to give some feedback, but it, most of what you'll probably be commenting on would be handled through code review in the building permit process. But if there's any further comments on the parking, yep.
Yep. So I'm really excited at the proposed and potential streetscape improvements of this property on Haymarket Square. And I think it's a great opportunity to revitalize that building and reintegrate the two sides that have clearly been separated for a long time. The materials have changed substantially as you move up from the stairs. So a couple quick points. I think it'd be great if that parking space was removed and landscaped to bring back the symmetry of the original design of the building. I can see a couple of magnolia trees, one on each side, being, this is a back bay building when you go by it. It's beautiful. I think you probably want to, until told otherwise, change your proposed conditions to a brownstone stair and cheek wall to resemble what's there.
Nick, this is going to HGC, right?
It is.
Okay, so can you limit your comments to stuff that wouldn't be addressed in HGC? Because I don't think we need to get into that level of detail.
Then I talk about the formalization that you discussed for the parking along the side. You've got a very wide curb cut there. I think it'd be good if you landscape that one space to create the same edge you have on the other side. Same radii. Looks like you've got probably some brownstone or granite on the right-hand side that would not be reviewed at the HDC that should be considered so your left and rights match. Otherwise, it's exciting.
Yeah, so I think formalizing the space is going to be useful.
Yeah, we would show,
designating them somewhere.
Show the space sizes on the plan.
Yeah.
Yep.
Dave, anything?
Peter? No comment on parking.
What?
No comments on parking.
Peter?
Okay. Oh,
Eric?
Yeah, I think that space in the front should not be used as a, it's just too tight to get in and out of that spot there.
Okay.
But the other two on the side, they could stay as they are. Have to back out or back in, it's not great, but it's what it is.
Yeah. Pat, as long as they address the code issues, you're okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And
what it is now.
Mark, anything?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, all set.
And so the only change in the utilities, just so you know, you're aware, is would be at this point is bringing in a sprinkler service.
Mm-hmm.
And the plan is to bring that in to one side and then split it on the inside and bring it up to the two sides.
Okay.
And
so
work with the water department on that.
Yeah,
so that wouldn't trigger TAC either.
Yep.
So
that's all through the water permitting.
Okay.
All right.
Do you do a formal recommendation to the planning board or just give them the minutes?
We give them basically a summary of the comments. If
okay.
There's any
very good.
Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, the next item on the agenda is the proposed Moxie Hotel at 299 Bond Street and 53 Green Street.
Hi, thank you. Good afternoon. Patrick Kermans with Time Bond. Also here with me from the project team is Jeff Johnston. The project is a five-story hotel off of Green Street in the rear of the AC Hotel. Go to the site plan. So the hotel is going to be located in the vicinity of this existing one-story building that'll come down. And this is the site plan. The project is going to involve, so here's Vaughn, the new AC Hotel, Green Street. You guys are all familiar with that. The project's going to involve, it's a five-story, 80-room hotel here. What it will be is there's going to be a lot line revision between 299 Vaughn Street and 53 Green Street. So the new hotel will be part of the 299 parcel. In fact, the thought is that what they'll be doing is sharing amenities and you know, maintenance, stuff like that, trash alike here between the two hotels. So there'll be a lot of connectivity between these two. And the project itself, we are using the incentives to get that additional fifth story. We'll be providing 30% community space. It's been calculated based on the total lot area for 299 Vaughn Street. And what it is there's actually, if you look, I'll go to the next page. This is a more of a blow up of the hotel itself, and you can see the ground surface here. The continuation of the Green Street sidewalk, wide sidewalks. You would enter off of Green Street. We'd close up this curb cut right now that's kind of wide open and has some parking actually like kind of right in as you enter it. So kind of clean that up. The anticipated circulation for drop-offs would be come in and then you'd have to come around, drop your vehicle off. It'll be a shared parking between the two parcels, so 53 Green Street and 299 Vaughn Street. It'll require a conditional use permit for that. We included an analysis in your package for shared parking. The project itself, just using the downtown overlay district, if you took all the uses on the 53 Green Street site, the existing office building, the new hotel, and then the AC Hotel, it's 177 parking spaces would be required by zoning. And between the two sites, we're providing 185 spaces, but because they are they'd be using parking on two separate lots, we need a conditional use permit for that. One of the things we did was we actually took it a little bit further in looking at the parking and used the shared parking and zoning to kind of look at the uses and confirm that sufficient parking would be provided. So we used the downtown overlay district parking requirements for the hotel based on the shared parking calculation. Office does not have a parking requirement in downtown, so just to look at it, what we did was we used the parking requirement that's in the rest of the city of Portsmouth for office, and using that and coming up, walking through the calculation with the different time zones and the percentages, the peak parking that is required would be during the evening PM, which is 185 spaces. So we're meeting that parking in that sense as well. So in two ways, we're meeting it, both in the requirements for the downtown overlay and looking at shared use parking. Jumping back to the community space, it would be, you know, we have this wide sidewalk continuation, and then what we'd be providing is this connection out to the North Mill Pond Trail and Greenway. This portion of the community space is covered. You can see up here, actually, this is a floor plan of the upper floor, so you can see this dashed line is the cantilever over. It kind of comes up and abuts the back of the AC Hotel garage ramp. So that it would be a covered community space, but that does meet the community space requirement for a percentage. For stormwater, we looked at this, we analyzed it, and we can reuse the existing rain garden that was constructed for the AC Hotel and put the stormwater from the roof of the new building into that, and then we just have to adjust the weir heights, but we'd still meet treatment requirements per NHDES regulations. We actually did contact DES just to see if this would even need to be an amendment to the alteration of terrain permit, and in their view it wasn't, because really, we're not changing impervious surface out here. It's building for building for the most part. So we did look into that. There is, you look at it, there is like a small increase in flow, but that's allowed by DES rules because there is a direct discharge into tidal waters. So I think it's the maximum rover is probably, there is a preliminary drainage analysis in your package. And this is, you know, looks, there are two points of analysis that we looked at. Some of the flow, there's a little bit of flow that goes out towards Green Street. Most of it comes back towards North Mill Pond. So analyzing that, there is a slight increase, and that's just a result of not being able to detain quite as much in this rain garden. But because it's directed to tidal waters, we're not required by the state to meet those pre and post flows. So that's our preliminary design for stormwater. Utilities, this is very schematic. We're assuming a new transformer, back corner here. Anticipating that it will need to tie off of the existing switch that's across the street, similar to what was done with the AC Hotel and also 233 Vaughan Street. We still need to meet with Eversource to review that. Gas, I looked at that actually today. I'm not sure that this is the appropriate place for it. We'll have to look at that. I think it's actually going to be somewhere in the back here as well. The existing service actually comes through the parking lot right now and feeds into the meters that are back here. So we have to sit down with Unitel and figure out where exactly it is. We just showed it on this plan, but the hope would be is that we could potentially use what's already coming into the site, avoid cutting the gas into the street. And then we're showing two water services. Those are approximately in the same location as where the FDC connection is now on the existing building. So that's kind of, these is just a preliminary set. We haven't got into landscape yet. We do need to do that. We did just have our first HDC work session, so we got through massing. So now we're on to design. So now that they're onto the building design, they're going to be looking at landscape design and how we're going to program this community space and integrate it with the building design. We met with the planning board last month for conceptual consultation. We're going to be meeting with the planning board again this month for design review. So we're just trying to kind of do the rounds, get initial feedback from staff and the planning board and the conservation. Well, actually, this doesn't require conservation commission. I should say that actually, we're keeping this out, all the work out of the 100-foot buffer. What we're showing here is terminating any work up to the 100-foot buffer, and then we'd allow the trail to connect in as part of that project. So we are, the three permits we'll be needing, I think, are site plan review, conditional use permit for shared parking, and subdivision approval.
Okay, comments?
I just have a question about the community space that's covered. What's that gonna be like in there? It's like a tunnel, but what are you thinking about?
That's a good question. So the,
you could just pull the microphone.
Oh, sorry. I don't know.
Hi, that's come up a couple of times. So the lobby will wrap around there, so there'll be exits from the hotel onto that area or entrance points, as well as the current concept is a lot of glazing, as well as we've talked about public art and other ideas. We're going to render it and connect it to the, so there's a pocket park that we created as part of the AC, so the goal would be to kind of integrate those two pieces together. But as of yet, we wanted to kind of get through the first massing in HTC. They brought it up, as Nick will tell you, and we're looking forward to kind of coming back with some different ideas.
Okay.
If you have any.
No, I was just curious.
It's more kind of hardscape, yeah. Art, glazing, kind of lit.
But it'll be lit because of the lobby and the
That's the intention, yeah. It's not going to be, we don't want to have the public walking along just a blank wall.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think following up on that, I think that you're going to have to focus on how it's going to be inviting
yeah.
for the public. Not looking too like much like a private space.
Yeah.
I
think Wayfair.
There is a spot. There's a place on the rail trail in Newburyport that has that goes under a bridge,
yeah.
and it has art,
public art
on the wall, and it's lit and it's interactive and.
Oh, interesting.
I'm sure there's other places like that, but I'm just thinking about ways that.
That's what I thought.
It doesn't
when I thought
just
this.
Look like yeah. The hotel entrance.
Can you just say that, Aaron? That's news to us. So
it's the new rail trail that goes
it's
under
at
High
Hill.
Street. It's at Marches Hill.
Okay.
It's a Mass DOT project, but it's It's got some interesting.
Yeah, they did a lot with the granite as well, but they also did some art under the thing, like a sea.
Yeah, it has some
undersea
lighting.
Kind of.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And yeah, cool LED lighting, different colors.
Again, it's one example. I'm sure there are others, but it'd be worth looking at.
Thanks.
Other comments? Pat?
A couple things. So the access to the new hotel is not great for trucks. I just went there just before this meeting to just do a drive around of the parking lot there, and it's not great for even my Suburban to get in and out. In fact, I had to back all the way out. What would your plans be to provide fire department access to that?
To the, Pat, can you explain? I'm not envisioning. You mean to the back side of the AC hotel?
Of the Moxie,
of
the new hotel.
Of the new hotel, the back side meaning the part that.
Well, it would be the part not facing the AC hotel, yes.
Okay, so on the current 53 Green Street property side.
Yes.
Got it. Thanks.
So we want to see some sort of truck move. Yeah, we can.
Yeah,
because
the parking, because it's full park cars potentially, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, we'll put templates on the plan and show it. I mean, we're trying to clean this entrance up so that, you're right, there's kind of like a couple curb cuts, and there's actually some parking spaces almost like right as you try to enter there. So what we're doing is kind of closing that off and eliminate, you know, the spaces that have been kind of fall like in this vicinity here, the existing. So create this one driveway entrance so that the fire trucks could come in and access the building on this side here. But I'll put a template on it.
And then when you, not so much for, you know, just our apparatus, but when you get to that rear portion of the parking lot back there, you're showing 21 spaces. I just drove up into there. All the spaces were full, leaving no place to turn around, which means I'm backing up through almost a serpentine of cars. It's not a straight backup. It's, you know, a bit challenging to get out of there once you're. You know, there was nowhere to turn around. You were up there, you're trapped, and then you look at the flow.
Yeah, I guess we'll take a look internally with the team to discuss it and how we're going to improve. We haven't looked too much up here because we were focusing on just the changes here. We weren't proposing at this time any changes to the existing parking lot.
And that, is that just striping that where you come in and there's the right turn arrow? To the left of that, is that
yeah,
just
right.
Striping?
Yeah, for this
okay.
Schematic plan, yeah.
As you might recall, it's just kind of one big curb cut now,
yeah.
It's just asphalt, so it's, I think the goal is to try to clean it up and make it more of an inviting entrance.
When they do the combined, or the shared parking calculations on that, the event space in the AC hotel in the restaurant doesn't require any, that doesn't have to be factored in, that doesn't require parking, is that correct? Is that what you said?
We were just taking we took the parking that was approved as part of the AC hotel, so whatever was approved, that 114 spaces, I think.
Yeah, it's not a conference
yeah.
hotel. That's what requires additional spaces is a conference hotel, right? Is that, yeah, it's just a hotel.
Conference.
So they just use the hotel calculation.
Right. Well, there's conference area now.
Right, so they use whatever's required by the ordinance for that AC hotel parking.
And those people who are, if there is a conference, they're allowed to park in the parking garage at the AC hotel?
Yeah, a lot of the guests are already with us that are, they're already staying there. But yeah, if they come from the outside, if there's availability, we will park them during the day. But it just really depends. Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? From TAC folks?
Yep.
Nick?
You want to go first? Three quick points. I mean, I would expect once you've done the community space programming and design, the materials will start taking shape for the brick sidewalk to at least cross over the apron or the entrance to the covered passageway. Not seeing that on the utilities plan or any of the other layers, not a big deal. Just curious what you're going to do with that community space and make it inviting. Seems like you probably want to have another street tree in front of the Moxie, you did at the AC with similar spacing, given you've made the sidewalk a similar width. And then My final comment is just wondering if there's a better spot for that transformer than sort of sticking out in the parking lot with some bollards around it. I don't have an answer, but it'd be nice if it could be in a more hidden location.
Yeah, Pat, just to follow up, the requirement for the hotel is that there's 0.75 spaces per guest room plus one space per conference area, the 25 square feet of conference area. Sorry to interrupt. Go ahead, Nick.
The only other thing is that little bulb out coming in off Green Street. Mm-hmm. Seems like it wants to be brick or another tree where you've got nothing labeled. Again, I hope I'm on the right. Yeah, they all seem to be white.
Yeah. No, right.
Whatever.
Right,
you got a sign in it, a stop sign maybe,
okay.
Or something.
Yeah,
right,
right in this location.
I don't think,
right. Yeah.
I don't know if you need that. But.
Yeah, when we engage landscape, we'll start really getting into the materials here.
That's it for me.
Nice.
We're back and forth on the brick because the gateway piece is concrete on the other side where we did the off of Bond Street. So if you go between AC and 3S, that's all concrete going in there. So I think this is a
You're
discussion.
You're a long way away, but.
Yeah, we can have a discussion about if you want to make them similar or, you know. And wayfinding came up by Councilor Trace at HGC, which made sense, and we'll incorporate all that stuff.
Dave?
Patrick, the we've done a couple projects down there now, so we're pretty familiar with what's in the ground. And the location of the electric conduit right now is coming out of the transformer that's across the street. So you're probably going to end up having to reuse that conduit or replace it in kind, because Eversource usually requires 5-inch conduit, and it's probably 4-inch. But that's probably going to be the only likely path that you're going to be able to get electricity through there because of the congestion. A lot of the stuff that you're showing may not be possible because of the location of the railroad sleeves that we put in. So you're going to have to probably spend some time and give you what we have for as-built so that you can figure out where you can actually put stuff. The department would appreciate if you could reuse the sewer connection that's brand new so that we don't have a main that's very deep with multiple connections that don't exist.
Sure.
The water main, we are likely going to ask for a replacement of a water main on Green Street from the end of the sleeve on the railroad tracks to Vaughan Street. The curb line in front of the hotel should sweep a little bit. Right now you're showing it as being a straight line extension of the curb line for the AC hotel, and it needs to sweep out a little bit to the left because the road hasn't been widened on the opposite side of the tracks yet. So that's the way the traffic is. So the way that you have it drawn, it will be sticking out into the road. So you need to change that. And I think we're all a little concerned about what's going on for the stormwater behind the AC and the kind of the pit underneath the ramp for the to go under there and to add more stormwater and then to try to reuse that. I guess it's a swale, but it doesn't look like a swale. It looks like a, I don't know what it looks like, on the back side of the ramp there. So that's going to all need to get cleaned up in there.
Yep.
Before we're going to be allowed to move forward on this. And then the last comment is to make sure that the pump station that you're putting in isn't underneath this new building. Shouldn't share the same space so that you can access the pump station, pull pumps out and stuff.
That's a good follow-up to where the pump station is at the bottom of the building. So the I noticed 13.9 was the finished floor in the existing building. Do you guys have any basement plan in this building? Slab on grade?
I believe so. I don't know. I guess architecture they're going
to... Yeah, I have heard...
Sorry, go ahead.
Sorry. I have heard they're actually... They're considering a partial basement because there's an existing partial basement in this wing of this
and
building.
And it's actually
now.
Very deep.
Yeah. So, and that, I think
so
that
they must
new.
Have blasted it out at one time.
Yeah.
Wow.
And that's not, that wasn't something that we knew until we got into due diligence, but I have not seen a basement plan. So there might be a partial basement just because there's an existing.
Well, you'd have to have it, I think the floodplain code would be like 11 to do any kind of equipment or utility, you know,
sure,
pumps
yeah,
or
right.
electrical or anything like that. So.
Thanks.
Yeah, just I didn't see the floodplain delineated on here, the line. Do you have that?
It's elevation 9, so it's not going to, but we can, I can call it out.
I think that'd be helpful to show it on the plan at some point. Okay.
I thought I saw it.
Eric or Mark or Pat, anything further?
Yep.
No, just one thought on the overhang, you know, instead of overhanging the back alley, what if you overhung the front so you would, where the drop-off area is, would be covered, sheltered area for pedestrians and drop-off?
And have it open between the two.
Yeah.
So it's a good point. There's an architectural feature, and I can show you a picture if you want, but there are round arches on the brick building behind it. And so by moving the building forward, it covers one of the tenant spaces, kind of where Patrick's saying. So that was the intention, was to kind of keep the integrity of that piece. But, we can take a look at it. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Eric, do you have any comments on the trip generation at this point? I mean...
No, it's fairly low and
okay.
Not too significant.
Okay.
How many rooms is it? 80?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Anything that... You anticipate, will we need a drainage peer review?
No, I think the drainage is going to be fairly straightforward on this one.
Okay. All right, any other issues we want to alert anybody to at this point?
Just reiterate the issue, the curb line that Dave brought up, you know, how for Green Street.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
So would you kind of follow that line, the property line?
The curb?
Yeah, more or less,
yeah.
Yes. Do you know how to just
figure it out? You do? Okay.
Well, a little bit, yeah.
Yeah.
You have to tap that.
Save it.
Yeah, and then you can click.
Thank you.
All right, take care. Okay, the next item is 856 US Route 1 bypass.
Hi.
Hi.
Doug Green speaking for the project. So there's a new property owner here. They'd like to expand the footprint, and it's a slab on grade. They're not increasing the height, and they can meet the setbacks. This is just to accommodate more space for product and movement within the building. And that is the extent of it.
Okay, so this meets our bare minimum threshold for having to come to site plan review. So you will have to submit the, you know.
For formal session.
Yeah,
yep.
You will. So any comments from folks?
Utilities need to be shown.
Right.
We need to make sure that you're not planning on putting an addition on top of a sewer water service. So you'll have to have those traced out so that when you come back, they're shown clearly. I think there's a good chance that the sewer line is underneath that right side addition where you want to put it. So we'll need to know about that ahead of time. You're also increasing the sealed surface with that back addition where the coolers are going to go. So you might need to do some stormwater improvements on the back side of the building. So there's a place for water to sit so you're not increasing runoff.
In terms of the whole site, are you looking at it in terms of lot coverage?
Nope.
or there specifically?
There specifically. Also, the last thing I have, Juliet, is our records show that your water service comes up Burkett Street Extension and then sweeps up into this site, but it crosses somebody else's site before it gets there. So we're going to want to see that you have an easement for that line. If it's in fact there. If it is in fact there. Not quite sure where it is, but that's where the city thinks it is.
Okay. Other comments? Pat? Pat or Eric? Pat?
You're not showing a rear exit. Is there a plan to have a rear exit to meet the common path of travel requirements in that back storage area?
Rear exit in terms of exiting the building?
Yes, egress from the building.
There are two egress points currently. One goes in the front, one goes out the south side. Mm-hmm. So we're effectively keeping that same arrangement.
You might be exceeding your common path of travel allowance with the addition of 75 feet in a non-sprinkled building. You want to look at that.
Anything else, Pat? Okay, Eric?
It looks like the addition is displacing the existing handicap parking space or some other parking. Is that being made up somewhere else?
That is a good question. The parking is not particularly well delineated throughout the site, but we could certainly accommodate. There are going to be improvements to provide for better handicapped accessibility anyhow, but that would be certainly something that we'd include.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how the site meets parking requirements or if it's... Is this going to increase
this is primarily storage, right, that you're adding?
Yeah, there's no sit-down capacity. It's still functioning as a grab-and-go convenience store.
So it doesn't really impact the overall parking mm-hmm. requirement?
As long as they can continue to provide what they have today.
Yeah. But we would want them to update their ADA access.
I suppose you could call that a kitchen on the left corner there.
That's currently
that's labeled kitchen?
Correct. Yeah.
Oh, I did forget.
Yeah, what's up?
From sewer department, they want the grease trap to be exterior on this.
Okay. Eric, anything else?
I don't think it would require access permit from DOT. It's not changing use, it's just expanding the use. So.
Okay.
But it wouldn't hurt to check in with them.
Yeah, you might want to just verify. I think we might have talked about that.
We did discuss
DOT.
That.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mark, anything?
Good.
Okay. Peter?
I'm just looking at the fence. Notice in the letter it said the fence is going to be extended, so that fence will be the whole length of the property line?
The fence is not going to be extended. The existing fence that runs along the border between the Dennett Street homes and this property is already existent. So they were just going to repair it where boards had become broken. But there is a very defunct fence along the property line with the adjacent property going whatever direction that is,
the right
north up US 1. So that is going to be a new fence is going to be
that's
built
what
there.
I saw. Okay.
Yep.
That's to the north on Route 1. So
yep.
That way. Okay.
All right. Anything else? Okay. So you just have to submit for a regular site plan when you're ready?
Yep.
All right.
Great. Thank you.
Yep. And that is the end of our agenda.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Before you guys all start talking, let me turn off the recording.